Peace fill your dreams. Rest your eyes as you lie still as the moonlight. Lullaby, sleep, baby, sleep. Sleep, little Jesus, and rest in my arms. Angels will guard you from harm. For you are God's promise of grace from above. But for tonight, you're my baby to love. But for tonight, you're my baby to love.
Lullaby, sleep, baby, sleep.
Come and see.
Lullaby, don't you cry, peace.
Lullaby, sleep, baby, sleep. Oh, sleep, baby, sleep.
Good morning. Did you sleep during Sunday school? I know you didn't, because our Sunday school teachers are wonderful. Good morning. It's so good to have you here. Welcome to South Garland Baptist Church. It's a beautiful, beautiful morning, and we're excited to be here together in worship. Just a moment here, we're going to be lighting our next candle in our Advent wreath. Today is the day of peace, and that was a lovely lullaby that the choir just sang to bring us into that idea of peace as we sing this morning for the second Sunday of Advent. This morning, the camp family is coming to light our wreath, and I think we've got some young helpers from their family. Don't you wish you had that kind of energy? Thank you so much. Let's stand together and sing together. Oh, come, all you faithful. Stand with me. Let's sing.
Come.
seated.
It's appropriate that we just sing, "Oh, come all ye faithful," because at this time we are celebrating the new faith of two members of our church family, Cindy Braley and Megan Weeks. In Matthew chapter 28, some of the last words that our Lord spoke to his disciples before ascending into heaven was to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Baptism is an outward marker of an inward reality. It is a sign of what has already taken place in the hearts and the lives of believers in Jesus Christ. It is a way to mark that transition from old life into new life, from the old creation to the new creation. And so this morning, we celebrate together as a church family the entrance into our family, the entrance into our heavenly family of both Cindy and Megan. So Cindy, I want to invite you to come first. This is Cindy Braley, and one thing that's very special to me about getting to baptize you, Cindy, is your family is already a part of our congregation. Kirk has been a part of this church family since the beginning of this church, which by my math means since he was -5 years old, Kirk has been a part of this church. But Kirk has been a part of us, your mother, Sally, is a part of us, and partly due to their influence, their, I don't want to say nagging, but they help get you here is what I'm saying. And we are grateful for that, but this is your decision.
Yes.
And it is based upon your profession of faith that you are baptized this morning. So Cindy, what is your profession of faith?
God is Jesus.
Jesus is Lord.
Jesus is Lord.
Absolutely. Well, then it's based upon that profession of faith that Jesus is Lord, that I now baptize you, Cindy, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried in the likeness of Christ's death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection. Got some unsteady bricks here, and so I'm learning my lesson from a moment ago. One of the great joys of multi-generational worship, of a multi-generational church family, is seeing children come to faith in Christ based upon the witness of their families. And so it's so special to me today to be here with Megan, because this family, your mom, your dad, your sister, and you, you've been part of us for years and years and years. And when you came to me saying that you wanted to be baptized, it was based upon conversations you'd already had with your family, based upon their leadership. They introduced you to Jesus, and they helped lead you to faith, and I'm so grateful for that. But just as I told Cindy, this is your decision. This is your profession of faith. So Megan, what is your profession of faith?
Jesus is Lord.
Amen. Then Megan, it's based upon that profession of faith that I now baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried in the likeness of Christ's death, and raised in the likeness of his resurrection. As we continue now in worship, let's go to our Lord now in prayer. Father, we thank you for this blessed, wonderful day. Lord, we thank you for the faith of these two, a faith that is now confirmed through this ordinance of baptism. Lord, we thank you for what baptism symbolizes, the burial of the old self and the rising up into faith in Christ. We're thankful for the faith that these two have displayed, And I pray that we as a church family would be with them now every step of the way as they continue in the walk of faith that has already begun. I pray that we would be a source of support, that we would be a source of encouragement, that we would be a source of love for both of these. We thank you for the joy that comes on a day like this, and we thank you for the opportunity to worship you in spirit and in truth. It's in Jesus' name that I pray.
All right. If I can get all the littles to come over here, we have our children's sermon. Okay. I have a question for you guys. Have any of you ever made a promise? Nope. Not you. You've made a promise before? Okay. Well, if you've never made a promise, then the next question doesn't really matter. How many of you have ever broken a promise? You feel like you might have broken a promise? Okay, yeah. Maybe you didn't. So whenever somebody breaks a promise, right, a promise when it says, you tell somebody, you say, I won't tell anybody that you fell down, right, or whatever it was. I don't know what kind of promise you break. But, you know, it's like, I won't tell anybody that this happened to you, maybe because sometimes it's embarrassing or whatever. Or maybe you make a promise, it's like, oh, I promise I'll go to this thing, right? Like you promise somebody you're going to show up to their birthday party or whatever it is or whatever might happen, and then you don't or aren't able to do that. Sometimes because you forget, sometimes because you can't, or sometimes because maybe you were lying, right? There's a lot of reasons why people break promises, right? I know one of the promises that I had, for Adeline one time is I told her we're going to go to McDonald's, and we drove by like 3 McDonald's, and then I forgot that we were supposed to go to McDonald's, and then we went home, and I was like, it's okay, because I have frozen chicken nuggets that I can put in the air fryer, and I have French fries that I can put in there, right, and we can eat that. It's the same thing, right? Is it the same thing? No. Some people over there know that too, right? It is not the McDonald's French fries, and it is not the McDonald's chicken nuggets, right? But I tried. Does that matter? Yes, right? It should. Absolutely. You're my friend. I like that. You need to go tell her that, right? But I broke that promise because I totally forgot about that, right? Sometimes we break promises, right? But here's one thing that we're going to talk about today, is about the promises that God makes for us, right? A long, 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 long time ago, God made a promise to a guy named Abraham. Any of you know a guy named Abraham, right? He had many sons, right? And so that guy, he made a big promises to him, promises that took a really long time, but whenever Jesus was born, a lot of those promises were fulfilled, right? So that's what we're going to be talking about, because Jesus is one of those promises that God makes to us, that he fulfills, that we still have today. Right, the promise that he will love us, that he will care for us, that he will bring salvation to us. And so God never breaks his promises. So that's what we're going to be talking about today, okay? So we're going to pray real quick. We're going to pray, and then we're going to go back to our seats. God, thank you because you are good, and you keep all your promises. Even though we might think you are not God, you truly are. We give you all the honor and all the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's go.
Stand with me. Let's continue to worship through song. I heard the bells on Christmas Day. Let's stand and sing.
I heard the bells on Christmas Day. Their old familiar carols play. And wild and sweet the words repeat of peace. On earth, goodwill to men. night clear, that glorious song of old, from angels bending near the earth to touch their hearts of gold. Peace on the earth, goodwill to men, from hands of gracious King. The world in solemn stillness lay.
Singing. You may be seated.
The scripture passage this morning, a passage that talks about the people who find peace with God, is found in the book of Galatians, chapter 3. I'm going to read verses 6 through 9. Galatians chapter 3, verses 6 through 9. Consider Abraham. He believed God, and it was granted to him as righteousness. So understand then that those who believe are children of God, are children of Abraham. The scripture foresaw that God would justify the Gentiles, that's us, by faith. And the scriptures announced the gospel. It announced the gospel in advance to Abraham, saying, "All nations will be blessed through you." So those of us who have faith are blessed right along with Abraham, the man of faith. Let's pray together. Lord, it's our time in this service to give. But we recognize that there is no way that any one of us could ever come close to giving like you have given to us. There's not a single one of us who, giving even sacrificially, could come close to what you have given to us. And so on this season of the year, as we celebrate how you brought peace to us by the giving of your very own Son, know that we also want to be counted among the believers that love you, the believers that give to you, the believers, even through baptism today, who follow you. In the name of Jesus, your Son, our Savior, the great gift, we pray. Amen.
This is one of those mornings where, for me, between the baptisms, between the music, between the candles and scripture being read, it's one of those mornings where by the time I get up here, I sort of feel like the gospel has already been presented to you, and like I'm kind of superfluous at this point. Like, you don't really need a sermon to get the gospel, but you're going to get it anyway. You are not off the hook. They're not serving lunch yet anyway. So if you've got your Bible, we will be in the scripture this morning is from Galatians, but we're going to spend more time today in the book of Genesis. I'll explain that in just a moment. Genesis chapter 12, if you want somewhere to turn right now. Our subject for this morning's message, the theme for today's service, and indeed the theme for this entire week of the season of Advent, is that of peace. This is the Advent week of peace. And in a way that's unique, I think, to peace, this is an area in which the biblical definition varies quite a bit from the cultural definition. Because when we think about the way that our culture, the way that our society, the way that our world views peace, defines peace, it is typically as a negative. What I mean by that is we say peace is the absence of something else. Peace is when you don't have conflict, when you don't have war, when you don't have fighting. That's what peace looks like. It's the absence of these negative things. And that's typically how we judge peace in our world. Nations are at peace when they are not at war. Coworkers are at peace when they are not fighting. Families are at peace when there's no disagreement between them. That's how we understand peace. But Scripture gives a fuller understanding of peace. And to help explain this, often music can do what words cannot. So I've enlisted Laura Joy, our organist, to help me out with this, to first give us an idea of what conflict feels like when you're in the middle of conflict. Laura? Isn't that kind of what it feels like when you're in the middle of a fight? When you're in the middle of a conflict of some kind, the musical word for that is dissonance. It's when you've got all of these different forces competing with one another, going at each other in such a way that it's not producing a unified sound. And in a way that is really never true when Laura plays that organ, it sounds ugly. It doesn't sound good. So the way our world would say that we ought to understand peace is what you need to do is remove all of that competition, remove all of that conflict. And if you take away the conflict, then you will get peace. So Laura, will you play me a G? Now that was much better, wasn't it? That was much, much better. We took away all of those competing notes, took away all of that dissonance, and we were left with something that sounded much better than what came before. But what Scripture would tell us about peace is that nevertheless, it's missing something. Because what you heard just then was not so much peace as isolation. One single note, which certainly sounded better than the dissonance, but it's still missing something beautiful. It's not all that it could be. This is what peace sounds like. Not dissonance, not isolation, but harmony. The coming together of all of these different forces to produce something more beautiful than what could come about in isolation. That's what peace sounds like. So that's what we're going to look at this morning from Scripture. Laura, thank you so much for your help with that. See, peace is not about eliminating conflict in relationship. Rather, it's about restoring harmony in a relationship. In terms of the relationship between God and humanity, we talked just last week about what the problem is, about what the conflict is. It's the result of sin. It's the result of sin's entrance into our world through the disobedience of our forefather Adam and our foremother Eve. When they brought sin into the world by their disobedience, it corrupted not only the world around them, but it corrupted humanity itself. Though we bear the image of God, we find ourselves separated from God. Adam and Eve were cast out of Eden, and all of us remain separate from God, but for action that he takes. So that's the conflict. Sin is in our world, sin is in our hearts, and something has to be done about that in order to restore our relationship with God, in order for there to be peace between us and God, harmony in the relationship. Well, if you continue to read in the book of Genesis, past where we left off last week, you see that it gets worse before it gets better. You get that story of Cain and his brother Abel and how, following the jealousy of Cain, he murders his brother, increasing the severity of sin in our world. We see how, following that sin, the entire world seems to devolve into a state of wickedness and lawlessness. How, with sin having been introduced into the world, it gets exponentially worse until finally the world seems utterly beyond repair. And that's where we get the story of Noah and the flood, where God comes to the conclusion that the best thing to do is simply to start over, to bring about a new creation of sorts, flooding the world and starting over with Noah and his family. And then after that, we get one small little story of all these new humans coming together and deciding to build this tower. That if they're going to be separated from God, maybe they'll reach him by building something that can climb all the way to the heavens. And God brings this creation crashing down, because it will not be by the works of man, but by the work of God, that the relationship will be restored. And that's what brings us now to our character for today. Because throughout this month of Advent, we're looking at character studies of individuals from the Old Testament. Because from these individuals, from Adam and today from Abraham, we get glimpses of what Christ would ultimately do when God sent his Son to live and die and rise again for us. So this morning we're going to look at three moments from the life of Abraham which foreshadow the peace that Christ would bring. So if you have your Bible, I said we'd start in Genesis chapter 12. And indeed, we look first at that very first verse of chapter 12. It says that the Lord said to Abram, and let's pause just right there for a moment. For all of you Bible sticklers out there, I'm just going to call him Abraham in this sermon, okay? We're going to cross his whole life from Abram to when God changes his name to Abraham. You know him as Abraham. I know him as Abraham. We're just going to call him that throughout, okay? Just ignore the inconsistency there, okay? The Lord said to Abram, or Abraham, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. And I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you I will curse. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. So what we have here is the Lord God reaching out to this man, Abraham, his wife, Sarah, and introducing a covenant between him and them, making a promise to them. And here's what I find so interesting about God doing that. There's nothing to indicate for us that Abraham was anybody special. Nothing to indicate to us that he was more righteous than all other men in the world, like his forefather Noah had been. Nothing to indicate that he was set apart from everyone else. Nothing certainly to indicate that he had earned this covenant blessing. I've pretty well recapped for you everything Genesis tells us up to this point. There is no story of the rise of Abraham and how he ascended to this level where God said, he's the one, he's who we've been waiting for. He's the one I'll make a covenant with. No, instead, This is purely an act of divine initiative. God is the one who reaches out. It's not a matter of Abraham earning the blessing. It's not a matter of Abraham achieving some level by which God would extend this covenant. This is purely an act of God reaching out to this man and saying, I will bless you, and through you, I will bless the world. The way you might think of Abraham's role in this story is Abraham as a representative of humanity is like somebody who's on a cruise ship and jumps off the ship. Because that is, in a sense, what Adam and Eve had done. They had been given paradise. They had been given everything. And they threw it all overboard. They thought there was something better if they disobeyed God and went their own way. And in doing so, they suddenly found themselves separated from God. In the same way that if you jumped off a cruise ship, you would be separated from all the other passengers. And all of a sudden, you jump in the water and you are flailing around. Because if you thought there was something better in that ocean, the moment you hit that cold water, you know better. And all of a sudden, you are wishing for the comfort and the luxury of the cruise ship. But there is nothing you can do in that moment to get back up. There is no ladder on the side that you can climb up. There is no way that you can climb up of your own initiative, of your own power. But then you look up, and you see the captain standing there holding the life preserver. It is his choice whether or not to extend that to you. His decision that will enable you to be saved. And what we see here in the beginning of Abraham's story is God throwing that life preserver, God extending his salvation to humanity, God taking the first step which we could never take. It is here that the covenant is established that Jesus will ultimately fulfill. And it begins not with us. It begins with the divine initiative of God. That's the first moment in the life of Abraham. The second is not so much one moment as it is one story. You see, God's covenant with Abraham that begins here in chapter 12 is elaborated upon in further chapters. God goes on to tell him that not only will I bless you, what I'm going to do is send you into a new land and it will become your land. He tells him that I will make you the father of many, the father of a nation. I will make from you a great people. And that is how I will bless the earth. But then, there's this long period where nothing seems to happen. Sure, Abraham has his adventures. He and Sarah get into all kinds of scrapes over the next couple of chapters. But this promise of a son, this promise of descendants to come, just keeps getting kicked down the road. And so we finally come to this moment in chapter 16 of Genesis where Abraham and Sarah have hit a point where they say, look, we were pretty old when God made this promise. And it's been a minute. And I know he's a good and gracious God, and I know that he's taken care of us and everything, but we did the one thing he asked us to do. We went to the land he told us to go to, and clock's ticking. So if we're going to be the father and mother of a great nation, maybe God needs a hand. Maybe what we need to do is take this matter into our own hands. And so at Sarah's suggestion,
shades of Adam and Eve, Abraham lays with his slave girl, Hagar. And sure enough, he becomes a father to a son, Ishmael. But something happens. The Lord makes it abundantly clear to Abraham and Sarah that he has not forgotten his promise, and that Ishmael is not the one through whom the nation will come. That while God has not yet kept his promise, he has not forgotten it, and he will remain faithful. And that Abraham and Sarah have erred, have veered off course in taking this matter into their own hands. But what I find remarkable is this. God doesn't leave them. We've seen this story before of God's people already this early in Genesis. We've seen stories where God's people disobey him, go against his will, and they are in some way cast out or in some way struck down. But in the case of Abraham and Sarah, God's faithfulness is more powerful than their sinfulness. And God forgives their sin and refuses to leave them. I find that really powerful because in thinking of God as Father, I'm not sure that's how I always respond when one of my children sins against me or disobeys my command. There's a phrase that comes up a lot of times, I think, in my house whenever one of the kids is doing something and I know it's not a good idea, but I'm giving them a little bit of rope, see where they go with it. As long as it's not something that's going to hurt them too bad, hurt our house too bad, I'll give them a shot and see if they can figure it out on their own. But when it inevitably goes sour, when something does break, when somebody does start crying, whenever things go off the rails, the phrase that comes out of my mouth a lot of times is, okay, you're done now. Big laughs from the section that's heard me say that before. That's the phrase that comes out of my mouth a lot. You're done now. You don't get to try that anymore. I am lifting you out of the situation that you have been in. What we see here between God and Abraham is that God doesn't do that with his child. He doesn't tell him, I'm done with you. He doesn't say, you don't get to be part of this covenant anymore. He doesn't remove him from the grace that he's extended. Instead, God reaches out to Abraham the hand of forgiveness and says, your sins, they are many. My mercy is more. One more moment from the life of Abraham. This may be the most famous moment in his entire life. It comes from the 22nd chapter of Genesis. This is that story where if God took the initiative in chapter 12 on behalf of grace, here we see a much different kind of initiative. Because God says to Abraham, as a test, the first verse tells us, take your son, because Isaac has come along by now. The promised son is here. Take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains that I shall show you. As an act of sacrifice to Almighty God, as a gesture of your faithfulness, murder your son as an offering for me. Let's just call it what it is. That's a monstrous command to give. It's an awful thing for us to even comprehend that a good God would demand the slaughter of a son simply as an act of sacrifice. But in these primeval days, it's not altogether unexpected for a God to demand a human sacrifice. And Abraham is tied to this God. And so, he begins this long walk of obedience. He rises early in the morning, saddles his donkey, and takes two of his young men with him and his son Isaac. He cuts the wood for the burnt offering, goes to the place in the distance that God has shown to him, there on Mount Moriah. And I appreciate the detail that Isaac asks his father on their way up that mountain, asks him, "The fire and the wood are here, but where's the lamb for a burnt offering?" And Abraham, whether as an act of faith in God's grace or simply to put his son at peace, says the Lord will provide the lamb. He places his son on the altar that he has built there. He raises the knife to kill his son. But it is then that the story takes a turn. Praise God for that. An angel of the Lord stays Abraham's hand and says, "Do not kill your son. Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him. For I know that you fear God because you have not withheld your son, your only son, to me." And then, just as Abraham had promised his son, a sacrifice presents itself. The Lord does provide the lamb for slaughter, a ram in the thicket that is shed as an act of sacrifice to God. You see, what we see from this story is the mercy and the grace of God. As I said, it was not incomprehensible in this time for a person to be sacrificed to a God who demands sacrifice. Abraham is willing to go through with this, it seems, on behalf of his God. But the Lord shows mercy, and the Lord gives grace. He shows mercy upon Abraham and Isaac, and with a sacrifice still being required, the Lord gives it himself. Once again, God does what we cannot. So here's the question. What does all this have to do with Advent? What does all this have to do with peace? We see each of these moments, each of these stories, each of these points in the life of Abraham as signs of what Jesus would ultimately do for us. How it is that Jesus would ultimately bring about peace between God and humanity. For just as God is the one who reached out to Abraham, just as it is that God is the one who extended his hand to his child, how God took the initiative, in the same way the Lord has done that for us by sending his son Jesus so that we might be saved. Because there's nothing that we have within us, nothing that we can do by ourselves that would bring about our salvation. There's no way for us to earn what only God can give. But just as God made that first covenant with his child Abraham, God makes a new covenant with us by the blood of Jesus Christ. Just as God extends forgiveness to Abraham and to Sarah when they veer off course, when they go their own way, in the same way, our God forgives our sins, paying for them by the blood of Jesus. Even when we wander, even when we do not do what the Lord has called us to do, we can go to him trusting that he will forgive us of our sins if we repent and come to him seeking a clean heart. If we confess our sins, the Lord is faithful and just to forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And how does he go about this? By his mercy and his grace. Abraham thought he needed to make the sacrifice. That's what he'd been instructed to do after all. And so often we think we are responsible for making the sacrifice, that we have to be the ones to take the action, that we have to be the ones to earn what only God can give. But just as in the days of old, God presented the sacrifice. God sent the lamb. God gave what we could not. And he sent his only begotten Son, the very Lamb of God, so that our sins could be bought and paid for. Jesus gave his life as a sacrifice so that we could be saved and restored to a harmonious relationship with God. Our world will tell you that simply to not have conflict is enough. That as long as the dissonance is put away, that that's peace, and that that's sufficient. What God calls us to between us and him, and I dare say between one another, is not simply a lack of dissonance, is not simply the emptiness of isolation. God calls us to the harmony of peace. And he gave everything that we could have it. Let us pray together. Father, when you made that covenant with Abraham so many years ago, you were setting in motion events that would come to their final fulfillment in your Son, Jesus Christ. You were establishing a family that would become 12 tribes, that would become a nation from which ultimately would come the Messiah. You were making representatives in this world of your grace and truth. And so, Lord, we thank you for the stories of Father Abraham and for how they foreshadow and point to our Lord. We thank you for these shadows that are overwhelmed by the glorious light of our Savior Jesus Christ. And so, Father, I pray that for those whose relationship with you has been restored by what Jesus did on the cross, that for those who know the peace of Christ, a peace that surpasses all understanding, I pray that we would be makers of peace in this world. Lord, that as followers of Jesus Christ, followers of the Prince of Peace, Lord, that we would not be agents of dissonance in this world, but rather bearers of harmony. Lord, that we would be a people who seek reconciliation, who seek restoration, who extend forgiveness and mercy and grace. That having been saved by your grace, we would be agents of grace in this world. Father, thank you for sending your Son to be the sacrifice that we could never be, to give the gift we could never earn. Thank you for the peace of Jesus. It's in his name that I pray all these things. Amen. In just a second, we'll sing together that beautiful hymn, All Is Well, that speaks of the peace of our Lord. If this morning what you have heard, what you have seen, has spoken to your heart, if this morning you wish to know more about the peace that can only come from Christ, if you wish to see that relationship between you and God restored to the fullness God always intended, then don't leave without coming and talking to me. I'll be right down here at the front, ready to talk with you and pray with you and tell you more about this good news that Scripture proclaims. For now, with our minds dwelling on this idea of peace, let us stand together and sing that hymn, All Is Well. Let's stand and let's sing. Amen. Thank you for your presence here today. Thank you for this wonderful morning of worship. And as we get ready to depart together, I'll just leave you with this word of benediction, that in a world of conflict, in a world of war, in a world of fighting and infighting, and yes, of dissonance, God has sent the Prince of Peace. So may we be peacemakers in this world, going forth in his name. Go in peace. Thank you.